So this morning, we are fortunate to have Dr. Aryan Tupatundru and Wisnu Harto to present their study on economic risk at the local or subnational level. So without further ado, I give the floor to Aco and Wisnu. So we usually have about 30 to 40 minutes for presentation, and then we have Q&A. Okay, silakan Aco dan Wisnu.
Thank you, Lydia. Wisnu will run the presentation from his end. Okay. Well, thank you so much for all the attendance. It's grateful to be here talking with you all. And special thanks to FKP, especially Lydia, to organize this event. I'm also very thankful to collaborate with my colleague, my friend, Wisnu Harto Adiwijoyo, who is now with the TBWA Indonesia. He was here at the ANU some years ago before he came back to Jakarta, had a stint in the World Bank and others before he joined the TBWA Indonesia now as one of the data scientists in this company. And today we are going to discuss our recent project on COVID-19. We try to look at the economic risks of the pandemic of the COVID-19, but through local perspective. Pardon the typo there. The idea is we read this a paper in the COVID-19 journals by Noi et al. Last year. And they looked at the economic risk of COVID-19 at the global level. So we tried to replicate their approach with Indonesian context, but we're interested to see the variation in the local level. So that's the basic idea. So if Wisnu can go to the next slide, please, Wisnu. Okay, so let me set the scene. So as I said, we're looking at the COVID-19 pandemic, and we understand that the virus, the SARS-CoV-2, does not discriminate, but the spatial spread or the geographical distribution depends on the response to the virus, to the pandemic, by the people, by the government, policies, all that, right? And it's unfortunate that Indonesia is one of the most severely affected countries in the world, as you can see from so many data out there. But we believe there are variations at the subnational levels. We read in the media, this government, local government does something, other governments does other things, and other government does not do anything, for example. So we suspect there are some variations also. But we are interested to look at the economic risks, once again, not just the risk itself in terms of health, morbidity, and things like that, but the economic risks. And we investigate this using the approach by, as I mentioned, Noi et al. 2020, in the COVID economics, it's the name, COVID economics, the speed journal. And they're using this, what we call HEVR approach, and that is hazard, exposure, vulnerability, and resilience. So the idea is that economic risk is actually the interaction between among these four disaster factors: hazard, exposure, vulnerability, and resilience. Of course, the hazards in this case is the COVID itself, right? But then exposure, whether you are exposed to busy places, public space, you go to bus station often and things like that, And then vulnerability is about, you know, whether or not you have, I mean, in your area, there is a big share of elderly in the population, and also vulnerable in the sense of lacking health capacity and things like that. And then resilience. Resilience, unlike the other three factors, is actually the negative, the opposite force. So hazard is negative, of course. Exposure makes you more, of course, exposed. Vulnerability, but then resilience is actually counter to that. So later you will see that actually resilience is in, we expect to come negative in the model. So our results so far, again, I have to mention at the outset, in the beginning, that actually this is more of data exploratory work. So we do a lot with data, not so much on the deep economic analysis yet, but we hope that we are providing a good, a database for monitoring the economic risks of COVID-19 at the subnational level. That's our objective. So we confirmed that economic risk of COVID-19 correlates strongly with the spread, and the highest economic risks are in the western part of Indonesia, especially Java. You can see already that it's not very surprising, the finding, but what we want to contribute and we hope this work can contribute is to, you know, provide some kind of way to monitor the economic risk, the development of the economic risk in the local level in Indonesia. So next, Wisnu. I think after this, Wisnu, yeah. So I will let Wisnu to brief us on the current state of the COVID-19 in Indonesia and maybe also some of the data, the issues later that we encounter and some of the challenges. So over to you, Wisnu. You are on mute.
Sorry about the technical problem. Okay, thank you, Pak Arianto. So now we are moving on into what's happened with COVID in Indonesia. First thing first, we would like to see the timeline of COVID in Indonesia. At the very first time, like in the 29th of February 2020, we remember when our Minister of Health at the time, Terawan, rejects Mark Lipsy claim of COVID in Indonesia. And then, like he dares to challenge, like prove you can try to prove that Indonesia has COVID, but we doesn't have. And then after that, follow up. Just like few days later, like on the 4th of March, the first three recorded case of COVID in Indonesia were announced. And then after that, Terawan just like giving a joke that flu is more dangerous than COVID. And then after that, President instructed efforts to combat COVID in the 13th to 19th March of 2020. Next, President rejected the lockdown initiative by local governments on the end of March. But after that, Jokowi announced that COVID is a national disaster, but it's not a force measure. So like he doesn't really like to lock down Indonesia. And then after that, 10th to 21st of April 2020, we have large-scale social restriction, which is PSBB approved for some of the regions in Indonesia, one of them is Jakarta. After that, there is a report from Reuters based on the death case reported in the DKI Jakarta website. That Reuters reported that Indonesia might have higher COVID case than reported. At the time, like COVID in Indonesia is just like hundreds, like 300s, if I'm not mistaken. And then we go into May to June, which is like many people are reported to not following up to the PSBB or large scale social restriction and health protocol properly. And then we see that in the July to September, actually the government is lessen the PSBB, so it's less strict. And then there is a resurging case of COVID from the period of July to September, that makes the government in DKI and around Jabodetabek reinstate their strict PSBB policy on 12 of October 2020. And then this wave is also follow up by the questioning to our Minister of Health, Terawan, with Najwa Shihab at the time, like giving like empty chair in her event. And then we follow up into the recent states of COVID. Julari Batubara called by Indonesian Corruption Commission or KPK for COVID social protection corruption, which is the Bansos. Next, Terawan is finally getting reshuffled on 24th of December, replaced by Budi Gunadi. But at the time, 98% of districts in Indonesia are already having COVID case, which is like around 507 districts. And then after that, we come up to the recent event, which is January 2021. The government rebranding PSBB to PPKM, and like just another name. And then the first Indonesian COVID vaccination to Jokowi and some influencers like Raffi Ahmad. Then, so what's next to Indonesia COVID policy? We will try to discuss it when we try to see our economic risk as well. But before that, we also do some exercise as well on the data. So we run through a conversation in the social media regarding COVID in Indonesia between the period of April until September 2020. And this is the result. When we are trying to have the keywords, we can see in the word cloud that malas or lazy, and then masker or mask, like lazy to use mask, or like less awareness, kurang kesadaran, and then like menganggap protokol malas, menganggap protokol lupa, they think that the protocol is not really strict to them. And then from this conversation, we try to confirm as well with the data that is gathered by BPS. So this is like BPS doing their research around the same time as well. They are doing a survey to ISN or public servant, as well as non-ISN or like the private sectors. And they ask several questions, but this is like the most interesting one, I guess. From the result, we can see that people think that they are not following the health protocol in Indonesia because first, they think that COVID are not around them. So like they believe that there is no COVID around them. It's around the same between ISN and non-ISN. But when we see through what is the most sensible reason, they say that no principal punishment if not following the health protocol. So like if they are not doing the protocol properly, they don't have they don't really enforce by law. They can do it. They can just get away. So, and then the respondent, the highest one is 59% is from the ISN sector, which is the government workers. And then like, but for the non-ISN, it's lower. That means that 47 of them thinks that they are complying with the health protocol. And then there are other reasons as well, like masker and hand sanitizer are quite expensive. And then like there is a difficulty to work with health protocol. And then there is another reason, like following peers and leader or influencers doesn't showing a proper example. But no principal punishment if the main reason for the not following health protocol in Indonesia. So we can see between the social conversation and the survey, it's coherence. Like people not really following the protocol of COVID. So we try to see, this is like a small animation, what happened with COVID in Indonesia from the start until in the recent development. Okay, we can see in the first March, like there are just several cities and provinces in Indonesia like getting the case of COVID. And then day by day, like people are arguing about COVID, government as well. And then when we come into the July, it's lessened. Like people are ignoring just like, COVID is nothing or like not following the protocol. Then we see like Java is really red in the end of September. October, the large scale social restriction happened again, but it's slowing down the process a bit. However, when we are going into the January, most of our provinces already getting caught with the COVID. And then we can also know that 500 507 of them are currently having COVID infection, or like 98% of them. So next, we'll get back with from there. We will try to assess what is the relationship with COVID with the economic risk in this case. So I will give it back to Pak Aco for this one.
Thank you, Wisnu. To repeat again, so our research questions are humble. So we just want to know what is the economic risk posed by the COVID-19 pandemic and how it is distributed spatially or geographically across Indonesia. And the third one is whether or not we can consistently monitor the development. And this is where we wanted to, you know, provide or offer some mechanism to do that. As you saw from the previous slide that Wisnu had, the, you know, the little animation is actually, it's really heavy data work on putting that together to show the development from the day one until basically we can do it until today with all this data that we have. So next, Wisnu. So the approach, again, we follow mainly the approach by NOAA and France in examining the interaction of disasters, disaster factors. Again, they are hazard, exposure, vulnerability, and resilience. In their paper for the global level, they find that economic risks of the pandemic is actually more severe in most African countries, India, and also Southeast Asia continent. With the same spirit, we are interested to see how it looks like within Indonesia in the subnational level. Okay, because Indonesia in their paper is just one country, so quite homogeneous in itself. So we want to see further into what happens within our country. Again, this is a data intensive work, and we hope it can provide a systematic way of looking at economic risks of the COVID-19 at the subnational level. Next, Wisnu. So this is the basic, the simple approach that we use, that they use, that we follow. So basically, it postulates that the economic risk, the estimated risk, is actually the combination of these three factors: hazard, exposure, vulnerability, minus resilience. So we expect resilience to actually reduce the economic risk, because resilience by definition is the ability to bounce back after getting shocked by this COVID-19. Okay, next. So Wisnu will let us know again about the data and the sources and some issues that we face. So I'll give it over again to Wisnu.
Okay, thank you, Pak Jo. So we will now try to explore and like describe what data that we have. As mentioned previously, we are using HEVR method, hazard, exposure, vulnerability, and resilience. So first thing first, we will try to explain what is the hazard. The hazard is simple. It's the COVID-19 confirmed case per 1,000 people. And then we got the data from the Kawal COVID API. So thank you for Kawal COVID. They are opening their API for us. And like we can dig the data daily from like the start of COVID until the end of COVID. Although the API is still limited, but we will try to open it as well using the platform that we have in Indonesia Project later. The level of the data is in the district level. This will be the basis of our hazard of hazard indicators. And then the next one, exposure. So what is exposure? Exposure is factors that related to people movement, mobility, or like people who can expose themselves more into the risk. So therefore, the indicators that we are using in here, we derive it from Illinois study as well and adapted with our data. We are using the population density data. This is from PODES 2018. And then we have also a number of public areas within the districts. The data itself is a coordinate level from OpenStreetMaps. It's free open source data. We can grab it from API automatically using Python. the data itself contains like hotels, marketplaces, tourist sites, worship places, as well as restaurants. And then we also explore the transportation networks in Indonesia. They are from OSM as well, consisting from the airports, bus terminal, train station, water ports, and ferry ports. So we are using data from OpenFlight. They have the daily data of frequency of flights, and also we are using internal migration data from MOH dataset or like from the Capil in 2019. This is the example of exposure that we have, which is like transportation networks. We can see the transportation are centrally on the western region of Indonesia and foremost in Java area, Java Bali area. It's really dense with the transportation networks and public venues as well. So for public venues, we can see that a lot of tourist attraction in the southern part of Indonesia, especially in Java, and then there are just few or sparse in the eastern part of Indonesia. So that's our exposure example from our data. Next, we will go into the vulnerability indicators. Vulnerability related to something that is some factors that is weaken the economic factor of or like economic factor of the regions. That's why we are using the indicators of poverty rate or P0, and then like share of elderly in the population, which is concentrated in Java, and then like the healthcare facilities. This is coordinates data as well, and then we have infant mortality rates and out-of-pocket health spending. The sources are like from Susenas March 2019, as we don't have the Susenas March 2020 at the time. We also use the Dukcapil 2019, PODES 2018, Ministry of Health data, and Smeru Poverty Map 2015. We mix them into an index of vulnerability at district level from their previous level, subsequent level. And then the last variable is resilience. So what are the resilience? Resilience are the factor that is strengthening the region against the potential economic risk. And the indicators in here is like the their ability to cope with it. So we are using, because like this is more into digital, so we try to accommodate smartphone ownership and internet access in this data. They are from both from Susenas March 2019, and then we also have language diversity and ethnic diversity as well from Susenas and Dukcapil data. Then we follow up with their financing and strength or capability. So we are using debt to GDP ratio at district level as well as expenditure to GDP ratio at district level, which is data from Ministry of Finance regional budget data 2018 until 2020. And then their subsequent level, the lowest are at village level, but we aggregate them into district level. Next, this is our variable of interest, which is DALI. So what is DALI? DALI itself is stands for Disability Adjusted Life Years. So it is years of loss due to ill health, disability, or death from communicable diseases. So before DALI, mostly associated with zoonotic infection. So this is like most likely the same or similar with COVID, which is zoonotic as well. Therefore, we try to use it as DALI, we try to use DALI as our variable of interest. And then, but it's a health risk, yeah. So to get closer to the economic risk, we convert DALI from province level data to district level data using GDP share as the weight. So it's get closer to our economic risk. And then the data we get it from Global Burden of Disease Study 2017 from the IHME. The data level originally from province, and then we convert it with the GDP share as the weight to district level. Okay, thank you. I will get back to Pak Aco for the next part.
Thank you, Wisnu. Before that, I saw a question from Astrid Dita. How do you deal with the possible bias on the hazard component caused by the unequal testing rate among the region? We don't know yet, and we actually noted it in later in the summary section. There are things that we cannot accommodate at the moment, so this is just this is still a work in progress, data exploratory. But of course, in the later stage, we have to consider all this, you know, enforcement, the efficacy of policy, including and also testing, tracing, and things like that. So, not in this current work. Thank you, Astrid. So, continuing on from Wisnu. So this is the distribution of DALI converted to this district level. We can see already that most of them are centered in Java. And after we do some other treatments, this is not changing so much, but we can see some interesting findings, as I will discuss later. So next, Wisnu. So how do we deal with the data? So first, as Wisnu mentioned, DALI, we converted it down to district level from province level data. And then hazard, of course, hazard has only one indicator in this case, and that is COVID confirmed case. So we don't need any further transformation. But for the other factors, exposure, vulnerability, and resilience, as Wisnu explained, these three components actually have lots and lots of variables. So we wanted to reduce the dimensionality of this data set, but still retaining the importance of, you know, each information. So what we do is the usual PCA principal component analysis for these three indicators: exposure, vulnerability, and resilience. So next, and our PCA explorations shows that based on the usual what is KMO? KMO. The threshold that usually used for treating the PCA, especially for the first component, is it has to be larger than 0.5. And then we found that our exposure, vulnerabilities, and resilience passed this test. So we can use the first component of each of this group to use in our algorithm or regression to see the association with the DALI as the proxy for risk. I can feel that there's already implicit question in the room from my economics fellow. Is this causality? No, it's not causality, because first, we just wanted to see the association. And also, the DALI itself as the proxy for risk is actually reflection of what happened in the past, right? And then COVID itself, it's current. And then COVID is in the right-hand side, while DALI is on the left-hand side. So we cannot really think as that as a causality process, but we want to see the association between the hazard, exposure, vulnerability, and resilience with the probability of risk in terms of DALI, the disability adjusted life years. As Wisnu mentioned, DALI has been used for this kind of model by epidemiologists and some economists. You use it also. Some economists prefer to use value of life on the left-hand side, but in this case, I think DALI probably makes more sense because it is used mostly by epidemiologists in terms of natural disasters, especially zoonotic related shock, like, of course, in this case, COVID. I think in the past, they use it for malaria, diarrhea, and things like that. Okay, so these are the descriptive statistics. So the five indicator, DALI, converted to district, and then hazard, in this case COVID, and the first component out of principal component analysis for exposure, vulnerability, and resilience. We have around 500 observation for each, and we run this with the, some regression and to see the association. Okay, so next, Wisnu. So what was the approach? So first, we regress equation one as is, the first equation that that we showed. As is meaning that we didn't do anything. We just want to see the simple correlation. Of course, before that, we also run even the more simple. Before doing PCA, we put all the variables together. But of course, because we want to reduce dimensionality and we want to fit it in the context of HEVR. Narrative, so we did the PCA, but then we run the regression as is equation one, where we have the DALI on the left hand side and also the four components on the right hand side. And then second, we follow Noyes approach, is that to assume that the coefficient of hazard is equal across districts, and by equal it can all econometrically, we can just treat it as zero, right? Why are we interested in that? Because we want to see if what happens to the, as far as economic risk is concerned, when the hazard or the COVID or the virus is equally distributed, so everyone get it, right? In that sense, we just treated the alpha for hazard equals, and then we see what happens. And then the last one, we recalculate this using the weight, because we suspect that even among these four categories on the right hand side, there are some interconnectedness. So we wanted to normalize each coefficient. So we weight the coefficient again against each other, and then see the how much each of these components contribute to the economic risk in our sample. So that's the idea. So this is how we weight. So this is how we run the regression for the weighted risk. So the W there is the weight. You see now it's not alpha anymore, but beta, because the beta is actually the transform coefficient from alphas. So we normalize the alphas. So for example, beta one there is actually alpha one over alpha zero plus alpha one plus alpha two, alpha three, and alpha four. So the next slide is the formula is there. Yeah, so that's the way we normalize the coefficient, or we weight the DALI equation. And resilience, as expected, comes out as negative, the coefficient, but then we use the absolute number to normalize. Okay, so next, so these are the results. So the naive regression, whereby we don't do anything with the coefficient. So you can see here, again, it's not very far different with the one we show earlier, the spread of the COVID case. So you can see, so this is from blue to all the way to red. Blue is low economic risk and high. So now in this picture, it's not COVID case anymore, but economic risk. That is a risk that takes into account not just the COVID, but also vulnerability, exposure, and resilience. But as we see, there's not much different, but again, you can see that the concentration is actually more on Java part of the country. Okay, so next, when we do equal hazard, that means we treat the coefficient for hazard as zero, meaning that economic risk can come from all the other factors, because everyone already get, is susceptible to COVID-19. We can see that economic risk is low, but still the remaining, I mean, the risk is concentrated in Java, but as we discussed in the draft, this has a lot to do with the exposure and vulnerability. That means Java, especially people in Java, are more exposed, you know, to this being the most populous region in the country. Of course, they're more exposed to public places, transportation networks, and also when it comes to vulnerability and resilience, we deal with the share of elder in the population, and one of the variable is also poverty. We use P0 headcount, and of course West Java, for example, is the highest with the poverty headcount. So that explains this. And then also when we go to the third one, the weighted risk, we see again, it's closer to the first one, the one with the naive regression, but still now even more amplified the concentration in Java. So again, this confirms our hypothesis that actually, even though the COVID-19 is not discriminating, but they are, for some reason, the interaction with other components make the economic risks are concentrated in Java. And these other components, we think, has a lot to do with exposure and vulnerability. And when we regress, when we show the regression in the next slide, Wisnu. So this is the naive regression when we don't do anything with the coefficient. So we were able to collect all these many types of data from second quarter of 2020, third and fourth, and that means June, September, and December. So remember, we had the first case in March, right? But of course, we cannot do anything yet. There's no data yet. So, but we can do something in June already, and then we repeated the same exercise in September, and then in December. So you can see these are comparable from Q2, Q3, and Q4. So as expected, resilience is negative, and all the coefficients are as expected, positive, positive, positive for hazard exposure and vulnerability. And also we can see that vulnerability, for example, is actually have quite a big magnitude there. We don't really want to interpret one by one because basically these are just data, but of course we can say something like, you know, every 1% increase in hazard probability of exposure, for example, will increase the DALI by 4,483 days in September 2020. But again, this is Indonesia-wide, so 400 days is actually not too big in terms of the population. Okay, so the next one we show the weighted DALI indices just to see the contribution of these components into economic risk. So we can see here that vulnerability, pardon the typo, vulnerability in December is quite high, 24, and hazard of course as the main variable in this case, the COVID-19. But resilience has increased from 0.01 to December, it's 0.10. And next slide, Wisnu. Okay, so after doing this comparison, June, September, and December, we got some more data that we think should be taken into account, right? So we have demographic data updated from MUHA, Department of Negeri, and then we can also use corruption index for KPK. I think it's in the resilience component, because resilience also deals with, for example, government spending over GDP, but we don't know if this government spending is effective, so we throw in this variable, and then we updated our high frequency data with Google Mobility Index 2020 also, and then we re-indexed them with population data, and the result is in the next slide. So this is the result, because some of the data structure has changed, so we cannot really compare this with the previous three quarter data. But just to show you some comparison, the left one, the left columns there, the January 2021, it's the base. We did exactly the same treatment with the ones before. That means we did not include the updated data and also additional variables. But for the right one there, right column, we updated the data, we throw in more variables. So now you can see that even though there are some similarities, resilience is no longer significant in January. And we speculated that this has something to do with, you know, the effectiveness of, you know, like Astrid asking, you know, the testing, maybe people don't really follow the protocols and things like that. Okay, so that is something we are still trying to sharpen our analysis on. So those are the main findings. So next, Wisnu. So as summary, again, economic risks from COVID-19 pandemic are not evenly distributed across Indonesian districts. And we show that those in Java suffers the most. And as a contribution for data monitoring, we hope that this, you know, because we show that it is possible to employ many different data sets. We are thinking to build this a dashboard. Maybe we will put it. So if you are interested, you can check in the COVID-19 Indonesia project website. We will put a dashboard there, and also the data that you can download. But again, as a caveat, we have to note that there are some things that are not considered yet here in this current work, but definitely we want to look at them in the future work, and that includes health protocols, enforcement, effectiveness, and also the money the government is spending to help to relieve the disaster in terms of fiscal stimulus. So with that, we'll end this presentation now. So we're open to suggestions, feedbacks, question, comments. Thank you very much. Back to you, Lydia.
Thank you, Acho. Thanks for that presentation. Very interesting for me to see all the data, especially from the data point of view. It's amazing that you can scrape this kind of data for all Indonesian district level. While we wait for people to ask questions, you can use the Q&A box at the bottom or the raise hand function if you would like to pose your question directly. Those watching on YouTube, please write your question in the comment box and we'll transfer it to the Zoom. I see one hand raised. It's from Mbak Astrid Dita again. Do you think it will be worth it to enrich the vulnerability with proxy for population comorbidities in the region? For example, using data from RISKESDAS at provincial level. So that's one question. And also I would maybe like to ask a short question. Are there the differences in quality across for the data across the provinces or the local level? or you think it's relatively the same level of,
okay,
I don't want to say quality, but the gaps, okay, if there are gaps, you know, between the local geographic areas. Well, maybe those two questions, yeah, first. From
I think both questions can go to my Superman data scientist, Wisnu Harto.
Okay, maybe the first one is from Mbak Lydia, yeah. For the data itself, actually, we can go back to the Mbak Astrid's question in the first place, like the data for the hazard COVID, it's reported by the local government. Therefore, like the quality itself, maybe there is a questionable quality because like we know from Reuters report before, there is a potential that the actual COVID data is higher than the one that is being reported. And there is some dispute as well between national data and sub-national data. So when you sum up the data from Kawal COVID, there is a distinct difference in the West Java. And then like, and we don't really know which one is the correct one. Yeah. So I can say that for the data quality of hazard, yes, there's a questionable quality for the data. However, that's the best data that we know, and it's at sub national level. So we can try it. At least the pattern is similar, hopefully, to the original data. And then the second one for the rest of the data that we have, yes, there are some different qualities, I guess, because like one data is a high frequency data, just like Google Mobility, and then the other data is a point data like ODES. And then like they have different level measurement level. Some of them who are in the village level like ODES, we can easily aggregate it into district level. However, when we go from the province level data, just like the DALI indicators, we try to normalize them with some other index or weight so it can be comparable to the district level data. I think, I hope that can answer Mbak Lydia's question.
Yeah, and also we did look at the riskiest data, Astrid, but it's not really complete. And I think we end up using the ones they provided in their website. Is that right, Wisnu?
And riskiest das is not public.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's not also the problem.
Yeah, mm-hmm. The one that we have, I think it's older one, but yeah, we end up using those they publish in the web on their website. And also in terms of data, we actually had discussion with some of expert from health expert, epidemiologists, and they suggested us to, when we were struggling to bring down the DALI measures from province to district level, we need some weight, right? First, we used that GDP share. And then we were questioned by epidemiologists saying that, well, it's not really, I mean, why not use health indicators, for example, right? So we tried mortality rates as a proxy for the population to bring down the DALI to district level. The result, we cannot really read it. And then we're back to GDP. And then we think it is defendable because we are looking at economic risk, right? And bringing down DALI from province to district level with some economic measure, economic weight, in this case, GDP, we think it's the correct way to do it. So we're back to using it.
Okay. I don't see any other questions. I didn't see that you had already, I know this is preliminary study, so perhaps you don't want to provide recommendations or policy implications yet.
Yeah.
But maybe something about your finding compared to the models that was implemented in Africa and India, for example? Is it comparable or not really comparable? That's but I see that Ibu Ninu, okay, sorry. Ibu Ninu also has a question in the Q&A box.
Yeah, I will tend to Mbak Ninu's question shortly. But just to your point about the comparability with noise approach, again, noise, is looking at the global level, but we basically replicate their approach. So in terms of methodology, I think they're comparable, but the findings are quite starkly different. Why? Because they actually find that the economic risks are concentrated in poor sub-Saharan African, India, and also some part of South Asia, not New York or Boston, for example. But in our case, I think because of the exposure and vulnerability is quite prominent in our findings, that makes Java as the most populous, you know, region in Indonesia as having the highest economic risk, which brings me to Mbak Ninu's question. We have not crystallized the policy implication of this work, Mbak Ninu, but I think what we can learn from this exercise is to look at again what components behind these factors, among the four factors that really stand out, right? So as we asked already, one of them is actually the exposure. So that also, to some extent, referring to the Astrid's question and other questions also, so the effectiveness of enforcement of distancing policy, for example, and how do you deal with COVID safe plan and the tourism sites or restaurants, airports, that I think is something that, well, we know that already, right? But I think we provide more evidence that we really should be more vigilant in enforcing this type of policies. Okay. Question from Mas Budi. How about instead of conducting a correlation, but just produce a map on COVID risk, such as the work of Arif Yusuf for climate change vulnerability mapping? Oh, that's a good idea, Mas Budi. And I think I'm sure Wisnu can do this. So we can produce map like our friends in SDG Center do for vulnerability, you know. And so we're actually also inspired by Smeru and producing poverty map, but in this case we want to produce economic risk map. Okay. Sorry, Wisnu, do you have something to add?
Oh no. I just agree.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks, Mas Budi.
Yeah, that's probably that's a good approach ya. Jadi bisa dilihat oleh setiap local government how they compare with the other with their neighbors or their peers gitu ya in terms of where they are in the economic risk. I see that there is a question from Ibu Hasna Nirangkuti. I'm wondering if this approach or model can also be used to measure the impact of COVID on some macro indicators for RPJMN, such as nutrition status.
Maybe Wisnu can add, but I think as one of the variables in the grouping of vulnerability, I think that can be included. But your question is more like the impact of COVID on the government approach to dealing with stunting and others. I don't know how to do that, but I think if we somehow put the variable of stunting or wasting in the principal component analysis, it won't change too much because it will be just one of the components in the vulnerability indicator group. But having them there provide an evidence that we can say something about policy related to dealing with COVID-19 when it comes to addressing issues like stunting and wasting. I hope that is in the direction that you wanted to see. Or Wisnu, maybe you can add something.
Actually, I agree with Pak Ajo ya. When actually, Mbak Manani asking on the impact of COVID to nutritional status, so that's different with our models. But when we want to embed it into our model, nutrition status actually quite correlated with poverty status as well, in some studies. So I can say that we can add them into our dimension, yes, but the result won't be changed much as it's highly correlated with another factor that we use, which is the P0 or poverty rate.
But it just comes to my mind. But also related to that, I have another paper with Pipa actually, which is coming up in the Indonesia Update book soon, about the impact of COVID on the food accessibility, but it also include nutritional status, because our hypothesis there is that, you know, when in this time of COVID, because poor family has even lower income, they switch their consumption from more nutritious food to less nutritious food, to you know, perishable food to long lasting food, instant noodle and things like that. So just like what happened in the Asian financial crisis, we see a deterioration in the nutritional status 5-6 years after the event. Thanks.
Okay, that's a good question, Ibu Hasnani. I don't see any other questions. If you would like to ask a question, please use the Q&A box or the raise hand feature. You can find it at the bottom of your screen. If not, I ask another question.
Sure.
So this is it's probably a very apa ya? Ketahuan pertanyaannya from older generation who's not so very knowledgeable about getting open access data from online. Maybe other participants would like to follow this mode of research, especially given now we are very limited in being able to do survey and actually field work. But this is an example of using big data, yeah, which is nowadays many people are already using, although I have not seen that much use in Indonesia yet. Is it something that you can say something about the quality of the online data? And for everyone who would like to do research in this area, what would be your recommendation, Wisnu, on the quality of the data availability for new researchers who would like to get into using data to assess public policy or public issues?
Actually, Mbak Lydia, talking about data, because that's the specialty of work that I do.
Exactly.
Actually, data is getting more open, and open in Indonesia. Usually, as an economist, we were restricted by traditional method of survey, and then like another method might be like either it's quantitative or qualitative. We usually using the data using traditional way. I mean, but it's a point data. You can get it like just once at a time. Yeah, but starting from 2018, I guess data is more open in Indonesia when we talk about education data. Yeah, because I was working for World Bank for education sector. Actually, the data is getting more open. Like when you see dapo.dikdasmen, actually data dapodik over there, it's scrapable. They have an open API. You can get it using Stata or Python. There are a lot of tools to do it. Even Mas Haryo Aswin Cahyono make a jokes, like he was using Google Sheet just to do scraping. So like you can do a lot of tools. But the problem is, I think the data openness is not followed up by the data transparency. So they have open data, but they don't provide access it to the public. So we have to tinker a bit. For some people who like puzzle or like they like to challenge themselves to get the data, just like the COVID data or like the data for the Kemendikbud, you have to tinker a lot until you find the API and then you can download it. It's an open API, but they don't provide it right away. So I think that's the challenge or the problem for Indonesia nowadays. The data is getting, the high frequency data is getting bigger and bigger, but for the data that is related to the government, they are reluctant to make it transparent. I'm not really know why. So me and several friends in World Bank, previously we tried to do an open data for this. And then like a friend of mine do the data.go.id, did data.go.id back in 2016. He has the same problem as well. Government don't really try to give it to the public. I think that's the problem. But the data is there. There is an open API. We can tinker it a bit. It doesn't translate directly into big data, but the data can be accessed. That's the thing. And then the second thing is, there is another big data that is less likely to use by economists nowadays. That's the data of social media. Actually, social media data is open and it's high frequency. So those two can be used for a lot of things. And in TBWA right now, I'm doing a consumer behavior research on precision marketing. And we heavily involved in using those conversational data to see what kind of behavior that people inhibit when they are trying to buy a product or something like that. So maybe in the future, I think we can try to use this data more for our analysis. And I think JPAL for COVID, they already did some of the thing with the social media as well. So I believe like in the 2 or 3 years, the landscape of economics data will be changed dramatically with this revolution, I guess. And for the quality.
Okay, thank you, Wisnu.
Okay.
No, go ahead, silakan. If you want to say something about the quality.
The data quality, I think it's depend on the institution. Something related to the private sector, they have more reliable data, in my opinion, rather than the one that provided by government. Maybe because of business, so they need something that is more accurate. But for the government, maybe they like DTKS. It's a big data, actually. I was processing DTKS back in 2019 for the PKH recertification. It's like 200 gigabytes data. But the data quality itself is still depend on the survey method and updating process, and the government doesn't have the updating capability, at least in the human resources. But for the private sector, it's getting way better, and it's more, the quality is really high.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's good to know. Yeah, I'm always surprised the type of data that we can find that's available when I see presentation like yours and look at what the data, the references that you use. So hopefully that's a good resource later if you decide to make a dashboard for everyone to use the data and to start, you know, sebagai awal, as a start to working with large data sets. So if there's no other questions, let me thank the speakers. And also let participants know that if you would like to have access to the slides, you can find it on the FKP Cloud, Large FKP 2021 slides. Another question, okay, it's just a comment from Mbak Astrid about the work. And I think we all look forward for the final result, as she mentioned. Maybe, you know, like it's not final. Research is all always evolving, improvement in the model. And also, as Mas Budi mentioned, maybe it's interesting as a start to see the map and to look at the economic risk in terms of the spatial distribution across Indonesia. So, With that, thank you very much for all the speakers. And best of luck with the revision of the paper and on your future ongoing study in this area. Thank you everyone for attending. Thank you everyone attending on YouTube. With that, I will just share about the event that will be next week. It's still focused on regional or local impacts, this time on small island development, not COVID, but small island development that will be presented by our, is it sharing yet? Can you see the slide?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
By our friends at Universitas Patimura. So with that, terima kasih, and I close the session. I will just put the slides up on the screen for a little bit for you to read about our next event on Thursday next week. Thank you Acho.
Thank you Lydia. Thank you everyone. Thank you Wisnu. Galih, thanks.